to be, as I told you, Cyrus's son. He was a man called Cambyses, named after Cyrus's father. And this man apparently was exotic. He was so exotic that he had a corrupt judge flayed alive and had his skin put onto the judgment seat and had that person's son sit on it to deliver judgment. Something like Muhammad bin Tughlaq here, if you remember, another extremely quixotic ruler. And Muhammad bin Tughlaq was once sued by one of his Hindu subjects for having killed his son. And the Hindu subject had the temerity to ask for damages from the ruler. So it went before the court of the Qazi. And Muhammad bin Tughlaq, being apprised of this, actually appeared before the court of the Qazi. The Qazi got up for the emperor. The emperor said, sit down or I'll have you flayed alive on the spot. You are a judge and I am a suitor before you. You will decide this case strictly in accordance with law. And ultimately the Qazi awarded damages and Muhammad bin Tughlaq paid them. But coming back to Cambyses, we find that apart from this quixotic nature, he added one very important province to the Persian Empire, which was Egypt. Because at the Battle of Pelusium in 525 BC, he managed to defeat the pharaoh at that time, a man called Psammeticus. And it is said by Herodotus, who hated him, that he slew the Apis bull. Now, who is the Apis bull? The Apis bull is a bull required ceremonially for various Egyptian rites. And the bull has insignia upon it which do not appear on other common bulls. It is black first. It has a white spot on its head. And it has various other insignia such as a scarab on its tongue, etc. Now, unfortunately for Herodotus, who said that Cambyses in a mad fit went and slew the bull, we have in fact a stone tablet which tells us that he only wounded the bull, he didn't kill him. And the bull happened to live on until the fourth year of the reign of Darius. But apart from the conquest of Egypt and apart from his quixotic behavior, he didn't rule for very long. He also did one or two other things which were pretty ghastly. He had a younger brother called Bardia, who unfortunately he put to death. And while returning from the campaign in Egypt, he was told of a particular defeat and as a result committed suicide. So that is how Cambyses went. After Cambyses, the throne was up for grabs. And now we come to one of the greatest other rulers of this dynasty, the great Darius, Darius the First. Now, Darius, in this great rock inscription, which is called the Behistun inscription, tells us that he was the ninth in a series of rulers, beginning with Achaemenes. Now, because it begins with Achaemenes, the entire dynasty is called the Achaemenian dynasty. He tells us he is number 9. And he also tells us that he came to the throne by first slaying a usurper called Gaumata. Now, Gaumata apparently was a Magian. And you see somebody under Cyrus's foot. That is Gaumata. I'm sorry, under Darius's foot. That is Gaumata. Now, Gaumata apparently impersonated Bardia, who was Cambyses' dead brother, until he was found out and destroyed by Darius and 6 other friends of Darius. He also tells us that he had to put down a series of rebellions, and you see all the rebellious chiefs standing before him. And it is only after 4 years that he was able to actually reign over an empire, which he increased very greatly. It is under him that the empire actually went right up to the river Indus, so that we had the Pakistani part of Punjab ruled by the Achaemenians for about 200 odd years. Interestingly enough, we also find contingents of Indian soldiers fighting under both King Xerxes in his Greek wars and under Darius III against Alexander. Now, it is because this man was able to vastly expand the empire that the Achaemenian Empire really came to the forefront in the ancient world and became the largest single empire. It stretched from the Indus this side right up to the Mediterranean, and from the Caspian Sea in the north right up to the Red Sea in the south. A little more about the rock inscription. You will find above Darius, Ahura Mazda, that is God in Zoroastrianism. Ahura Mazda, according to Darius, was the one great creator god by whose blessings he ruled. There's a very beautiful inscription, which we don't have here, unfortunately, but which is on the palace walls at Persepolis, which says that I worship Ahura Mazda, I, Darius, worship Ahura Mazda, who created the earth and the sky and man and happiness for man. Beautiful. This inscription, by the way, is trilingual. It is in three languages, but all in the cuneiform script. The first language is the spoken language, the old spoken language, Avesta, which is an exact sister of the Rigvedic Sanskrit. The second is Elamite, which was a spoken language of the day in a neighboring district called Elam. And the third, Babylonian, Akkadian. Now, it took an Englishman, a man called Sir Henry Rawlinson, a number of years with considerable risk to his life to go up here and copy everything that was written. And ultimately, he was able to crack the code. And in 1837, for the first time, he cracked the Avestan code. And 1843, he was able to translate the Elamite part and the Akkadian part, because it was realized that all three inscriptions said exactly the same thing. Incidentally, Ashoka's rock edicts, which came shortly after, and the Rosetta Stone, which you see in the British Museum, all copied this form of writing something. Ashoka also had bilingual inscriptions, and he had them in Kharoshti, he had them in Brahmi, all, of course, speaking in the Prakrit language. And apart from Ashoka, Ptolemy V said pretty much what he wanted to on the Rosetta Stone, again, which was trilingual. This time, with Egyptian hieroglyphs on top, another Egyptian language called Demotic below it, and then a third language, which was Greek. Now, each of these great rock inscriptions were deciphered within about 20 years of each other. And you had remarkable people who did them. Champollion, a Frenchman, was able to decipher ancient Egyptian hieroglyph sometime in 1822. And we have another Englishman called James Prinsep, who happened to decipher the Ashokan bilingual and lingual inscriptions sometime in the 1840s. So within about 20 years of each other, suddenly a number of dead languages came alive, and history that was completely dead to the world also came alive with them. Now, this inscription, interestingly, tells us that Darius says that he put down the rebellions, that ultimately he was able to rule because he put Gaumata down, and then goes on to say that I had conquest after conquest. But there are two very interesting things that he says. One, that I am not telling you, in fact, I'm telling you a fraction of the things that I have done. Because if I were, in fact, to tell you what I have done, you'll think I'm a liar. And secondly, he also says that a curse is upon those who do not protect this inscription, and a greater curse on those who try to destroy it. Ultimately, the inscription ends with saying that he conquered many lands, and only in the lands in which there was no god did he introduce Ahura Mazda there. Now, apart from this inscription, you come to the other great phase of Darius's life, which are the Greek Wars. Now, one of the reasons why Persian history has unfortunately been hidden from the Western world and consequently to us is because the Greeks were able to stave off the Persian invasion. Apparently, Athens, which had been conquered by him, revolted. And when it revolted, Darius had told the person who woke him up every morning to tell him, "Sire, do not forget the Athenian revolt." Something like Napoleon being woken up every morning and being told, "Sire, you have great things to do today." Now, Darius never forgot that revolt. And with all the might at his command, went at Athens, and you all know that in 490 BC, the great battle of Marathon took place, where a very few number of Greeks on the beachhead at Marathon, 9,000, were able to stave off a huge Persian army, and thus stave off rebellion. Now, Darius, therefore, in turn, died in 485 BC, without somehow being able to deal with the Greeks. If we may move on to the next slide. This is Darius's palace at Persepolis, which you all must be reasonably familiar with. Next slide, please. This is a painting done of the same palace. And with this, we move on to the next great ruler of the Achaemenian dynasty, Xerxes. Now, an entire book of the Bible is devoted to Xerxes, this book, the Book of Esther. And the Book of Esther runs thus. First and foremost, Esther is a Persian name. It is not a Jewish name. And the lady called Esther had a Jewish name called Hadassah. She happened to be the niece of a Jew called Mordecai. And Mordecai was serving in Xerxes' court. The Book of Esther begins with Xerxes being disenchanted with his queen, a name called Vashti. As a result of which, Mordecai, who was the Jew in the palace, introduced his niece Esther to the great king. Meanwhile, you had a person called Haman, who was an Amalekite. Now, Amalekites are traditional enemies of the Jews. And Haman, because Mordecai the Jew would not bow before him, somehow or the other got to Xerxes and was able to tell Xerxes that, look, you must do something about these troublesome people, because not only do they not bow to you, they do not bow to God Almighty as well. And therefore, you must destroy them. So a royal decree was sent out stating that on the 13th of Adar, please remember the month was called Adar in the Bible, of a particular year, the Jews will have to be decimated because of their rebellious behavior. Now, all this was known to Mordecai and therefore consequently to Esther. Somehow or the other, Esther enters the king's affections. And when she enters the affections of the king, Mordecai at the same time reveals a plot to murder Xerxes. So Xerxes somehow softens to the two of them and ultimately is told that Haman has given him a tissue of lies about their people. Their people are very God-fearing. Their people are people who will follow him, etc. So the famous expression, "the laws of the Medes and the Persians," occurs here. Now, under the laws of the Medes and the Persians, the moment a decree is sent out, you cannot countermand it. The only way of countermanding it is to send another cross decree. So, a cross decree was therefore sent, in which it was stated that the Jews will be better armed than the soldiery who are supposed to finish them. And thanks to that cross decree, ultimately, the Jews on that 13th of Adar had a tremendous slaughter of all their enemies instead of the other way around, which they celebrate till today as the great feast of Purim. And that's celebrated every year in Israel, even today. Now, all this is told to us in this book of Esther. The only source of information about this aspect of Xerxes is the book of Esther. And you will see Ahasuerus is none other than Xerxes in the Bible. If you move on, please, to the next, you will find here what is called the famous Daiva inscription. This is to show that Xerxes was monotheistic, worshipped only one creator god, and therefore railed against the worship of Daivas or many gods, or what he called false gods. We also find that Xerxes had his own campaigns in the Greek wars, which again led to great disaster. Now, Xerxes followed upon his father's defeat in Marathon, and the next battle that was fought with the Spartans. And there's a small group of Spartans, who, about 300 of them, who unfortunately, because of a traitor, were cut down to the last man, despite great bravery, at the Battle of Thermopylae, which is the only battle that the Persians succeeded in the Greek wars. Now, after Thermopylae came another very great battle in 480 BC, which is the Battle of Salamis. Salamis was a sea battle. And interestingly enough, when Xerxes first went over from the mainland to the Hellespont, which is to the Greek mainland, there was such a storm that he got repulsed. When he got repulsed, apparently, he was so angry with the water god that he had the water lashed 300 times. And it is after this that he went for his Greek war. Now, this brings to mind another great ruler, King Canute. Canute, of course, was long, long after Xerxes, a Danish king who also ruled England, who did exactly the opposite thing. If you remember, his throne was put into the water when the tide was rising. And with all his courtiers fawning over him, he commanded the waves to go back. They only came forth instead of going back. And then he turned to them and said, "See, I have no dominion over the forces of nature. Who am I? I'm a humble, small human being." But unfortunately, Xerxes was the opposite. And Xerxes had the mortification of actually watching the sea battle of Salamis from a promontory on top. Interestingly enough, an Athenian called Themistocles was the person who actually won the battle for the Greeks. And he won it in the following manner. What he did was, he somehow got all the vessels to go into a cul-de-sac. Now, the moment that happened, the Greek vessels, which were small, were able to fight effectively. The Persian vessels, which were big and unwieldy, were not. And they got trapped in this cul-de-sac. And as a result of getting trapped, Xerxes lost the Battle of Salamis. And after losing the Battle of Salamis, the next thing that happened was that they had a land battle at Plataea in 479 BC, which was also lost, despite great bravery by the Persian soldiers. And it was after this that once and for all, the Persians were expelled completely from the Greek homelands. And it is because this happened that the history that I am narrating to you and the history that is to come was hidden completely from the Western world and consequently to all of us. We now come to the next great frieze and accordingly the next great ruler, who was called Artaxerxes I. Now, for Artaxerxes I also, we have the Bible as a primary source. And here it is the book of Nehemiah, because we are told that somebody went to Artaxerxes and requested Artaxerxes to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, which was accordingly apparently done. And therefore the Jews praised him as a very great ruler. He was called Longimanus, which basically means one hand is longer than the other. So the Greek historians, therefore, Xenophon, etc., to distinguish him from the other Artaxerxes, called him Longimanus. And he apparently had a long reign, but a rather uneventful one, for the reason that ultimately he made peace with the Greeks and died 41 years later, leaving a son who ruled for a very short time as Xerxes II in 425 BC. And Xerxes II, in turn, left a son known to history as Darius the Bastard, Darius Nothus. Now, if you please turn to the next inscription, you will find the tombs of some of these kings, Darius Nothus, Artaxerxes I, etc. Now, other great bastards in history which come to mind are William the Conqueror, all of you have heard of him, Sargon the Great, the Assyrian, and of course the greatest genius, or perhaps arguably one of the greatest genius ever, Leonardo da Vinci. Another one that comes to mind is Confucius. But this man didn't do very much. He had a 20-year rule. And in that 20-year rule, there was a revolt of a son-in-law which was put down rather ruthlessly. This is about all we know about this ruler, which is not very much. Now, after him, we have the longest ruling king of this dynasty, a man called Artaxerxes II, Artaxerxes Nemon to history. Nemon means thoughtful, wise. It is during his reign that we have Mithraism being born as a religion, a Persian religion. Now, Mithra, as most of you know, was considered a great god in the Rigvedic pantheon. All these great gods other than Ahura Mazda were thrown over by Prophet Zarathustra, who said, we have only one creator god and none of the others. So these crept back into Zoroastrianism, this time not as gods, but as angels, as Yazatas, which is why you have Parsis today praying the Khorshed and Meher Nyais. The Meher Nyais is to Mithra, or the Mithra Yast, again to Mithra. And Mithraism became such a powerful force, particularly in the next empire, in the Parthian Empire, that it actually rivaled Christianity. And Mithraism, therefore, is something which left its imprint on Christianity in many ways. One most obvious way is Christ's birthday. You'll find that everybody celebrates Christmas. Was it Christ's birthday? Apparently not. The reason was, as the Bible tells us, that Jesus was a summer baby. Because we are told that when shepherds tend their flocks by night, the Savior was born. Shepherds do not tend their flocks by night in Israel at any time other than the summer months. So how was Jesus said to be born on December the 25th? It appears that in both the old Persian Empire of the Achaemenians, then the Parthians, and as a result, Mithraism creeping to the Romans, that Mithra became a very great god in the Roman pantheon as well. And when he became this great god in the Roman pantheon, Mithra being the sun would be at its lowest on 25th December or thereabouts. And therefore, annually, his birthday was commemorated on 25th December by the Romans. And when Constantine the Great comes in and finally declares Christianity to be the religion of the empire, this particular feast of Mithra had necessarily to be replaced. And how do you replace it? It's something like Diwali today. How do you replace Diwali with something else? So it was replaced stating that now it is no longer Mithra's birthday, but Jesus' birthday. We also have Mithra having 12 apostles, the 12 constellations. We also have, apart from his being born from a rock, another theory that he is born of a virgin, just like Jesus. And the Eucharist, which is, again, a very important Christian ritual, which is the bread and wine ritual, which is nothing but the body and blood of Christ, was apparently a ritual carried out in Mithraism when the bull was slain. And when the bull was slain, apparently, because of its slaying, the blood that emanated from it fertilized the earth and therefore gave rise to civilization. So you will see that a large number of the early churches' rituals actually had to supplant Mithraism because it had such a strong foothold in the Roman world. So this utters a